Now this morning we begin our study of the Gospel according to Mark. I've been talking about this for a while, but we got to it, you see. And most of today's class will be taken up with introductory matters. Now specifically, I want to address the authorship of the Gospel, its date, the location of its writing, its initial audience, and I'll also say a word about its purpose. And then I want to comment briefly on some miscellaneous things about the Gospel. Particularly, I want to say a brief word about what is known as the synoptic problem, which is really better termed a synoptic puzzle. But I just want to alert you to that. You may already know something about it, but I want to mention that to you. And then after that, we'll move into the text. And Bernard was asking me how long, and I never really know how long these things. I'm in my preparation. I'm up through chapter 12, so I can kind of have a guess, but as I go through and actually begin to teach each class, I revise even what I have prepared, so I may expand that, and I don't know how many of the last few chapters will take, so I don't know. You see here I put May 2018, that's my guess, okay? But I just teach it, I teach what I want to say as long as it takes me, and then I stop. So that's the only way I know how to work it. All right, let's talk about the authorship. Oh, I need my clicker. Yes, I do. Let's hope it works. Now, the authorship, I want to first talk about the external evidence of authorship. Now, I could just tell you that it's written by John Mark. Okay, but if I just tell you that, it doesn't really help you. Because it won't, the conclusions won't have any weight for you if I don't explain. How do we know that? You've got this document here, and you want to tell somebody this is written by Mark. Well, why do you think that? I could tell you that it was written. I mean, you could repeat that, and somebody says, well, why do you think that? And all you would say is, hum, 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 hum. I want you to know the reason behind that. What is this conclusion based on? So it'll carry some weight for you. Now, the external evidence, I first want to look at by external evidence, you know, it means outside the gospel itself. External to the writing. So what is the external evidence? And there's very powerful external evidence, strong and consistent evidence. From early Christians, they identify the author of this second gospel as Mark. In the early second century, very early in the second century, he winds up writing something around 125, 130. But around that time, Papias, he was bishop of Hierapolis, which is a city in Asia Minor. It's a city that's mentioned in Colossians chapter 4, verse 13. And according to Irenaeus, now Irenaeus was born in Smyrna, and he knew Polycarp. Now according to Irenaeus, who knew Polycarp, Papias was a contemporary of Polycarp and a follower of the Apostle John, as was Polycarp. So Irenaeus knows Polycarp. He tells us that Papias, who is the bishop of Hierapolis, he was a contemporary of Polycarp's, and he knew the Apostle John or was a follower of John. Now around 130 or a bit before that, Papias wrote a five-volume work titled The Expositions of the Oracles of the Lord, which survives only in fragments. So he writes these five volumes. We know he wrote them, but it survives only in fragments that have been preserved by Irenaeus, late second century, and Eusebius, late third and early fourth century, because they referred to this work of Papias's. Now Eusebius's, his final edition of the history of the church, it was completed around AD 325. So Papias writes these five volumes in, say, 125, 130. And then Eusebius quotes him in the early 4th century. And as quoted by Eusebius, Papias identified the writer of the gospel as Mark. And he specified that Mark obtained his information from Peter. Eusebius says that Papias wrote the following in that five volumes. He says, and the presbyter, and he's referring here to John, who almost certainly is the Apostle John, So Papias says, and the presbyter used to say this. So Papias says, John used to say this. Mark became Peter's interpreter and wrote accurately all that he remembered, not indeed in order of the things said or done by the Lord, for he had not heard the Lord, nor had he followed him, but later on, as I said, followed Peter, who used to give teaching as necessity demanded, but not making, as it were, an arrangement of the Lord's oracles. So Peter, he's saying, would teach these things as needed. And Mark is a follower of Peter, so this is where he hears these. So that Mark did nothing wrong in thus writing down single points as he remembered them, for to one thing he, Mark, gave attention, to leave out nothing of what he had heard and to make no false statements in them. Now, this is a very early expression of who wrote this gospel. Then around AD 150, some 20 years after Papias' writing, Justin Martyr, in a work called Dialogue with Trypho, he says, it is said that he, Jesus, changed the name of one of the apostles to Peter. And it is written that in his memoirs that he changed the names of others, two brothers, the sons of Zebedee, to Boanerges, which means sons of thunder. So as the two sons of Zebedee, they're called the sons of thunder only in the Gospel of Mark. In Mark chapter 3, verse 17, Justin then here, he's referring to Mark's gospel as Peter's memoirs. And so that's very significant, you see. And that fits with Papias' statement that the Gospel of Mark was based on Peter's recollection. See, so Peter is Mark is the author, but he's basing this on Peter. And so you have that not only in what Papias says, you have that confirmed in the middle of the second century in what Justin says. Then around AD 180, some 30 years after Justin's work, Irenaeus, who was bishop of Lyon, which is later France, he states in his work Against Heresies, he says, after Peter and Paul's departure, after they're dead, Mark, Peter's disciple, has himself delivered to us in writing the substance of Peter's preaching. So Tertullian, Clement of Alexandria, two other late second century writers, they likewise identify Mark as the author of the gospel, and they too indicate that what Mark wrote was based on Peter's preaching. So in terms of the external evidence, it's early, consistent, strong that the author of this second gospel is Mark. Now, it's almost certain that this Mark, this that they mention as the author, that this is the Mark who is mentioned in the New Testament, the person who's named both John and Mark, John being his Jewish name and the other Mark being his Roman name. So it's almost certain that it's this Mark, John Mark. You say, well, why is that? And you see John and Mark, you see in Acts 12:12 and 25 and 15:37. Why do you think that this Mark is almost certainly John Mark? Well, as D.A. Carson and Douglas Moose say, no other early Christian Mark would have been so well known as to be mentioned without further description. I mean, see, there is no other Mark who's that well known. So if you're just going to say somebody Mark, people would assume you're referring to the well-known Mark. If it's going to be somebody who's more obscure than that, well, you'd have to identify them. The default's going to be the popular Mark, the well-known Christian. And so that's one of the things that you can see, that if it's not that Mark, you'd have to identify him. Otherwise, your readers are going to assume it is the Mark that's mentioned in the New Testament. Now, Daryl Bach says in his commentary, he says, it seems difficult to accept the initial reception of this gospel. In other words, that it comes as part of the canon. People recognize that it's inspired. If the Mark in question is an unknown or random Mark, surely something that ended up circulating early in the church's distribution of accounts about Jesus would have had roots known to the early leaders who circulated it. After all, most gospel scholars see Mark as a source used by the other gospel writers. So we have this clear, strong, consistent external evidence that it's written by Mark based on Peter's preaching. And that Mark is almost certainly the Mark of the New Testament, the one who is known as John Mark. Okay, so that's who the author is. Now, the New Testament scholar Barry Smith, he well summarizes what can be known about this Mark from references to him in the New Testament. I thought this was a nice summary of what we can know about Mark. He says, John Mark was probably a resident of Jerusalem since his mother had a house in the city. He traveled with Paul and Barnabas from Jerusalem to Antioch and then traveled with them on the first missionary journey. He left Paul and Barnabas in Pamphylia. Later, because Paul didn't want to take him along on a second missionary journey, he traveled with Barnabas to Cyprus and other places. John Mark was the cousin of Barnabas, Colossians 4:10. John Mark is with Paul in Rome during Paul's first imprisonment in Rome. During his second imprisonment, Paul asked Timothy to bring Mark to Rome. He's with Peter in Rome when he writes 1 Peter. So this is who we're talking about. This is John Mark. Mark is the author of this second gospel. That's the external evidence. Well, what about the internal evidence? Is there any internal evidence, evidence that is part of the gospel writing itself that helps us see that this was Mark who wrote this? Well, in terms of direct internal evidence, that would be something like if he said, I, John Mark, tell you. You see, that would be direct evidence in the gospel itself. Well, there is no direct evidence in the text of the gospel, but it's very interesting that every manuscript that we have, all the ancient manuscripts of the gospel include a title identifying Mark as the author. That's not the body of the gospel, but every ancient manuscript we have includes in the title of it that the author is Mark. So that's something that's very significant. Now, at the very least, the title was added very early because all the manuscripts have, so it was very, which would confirm the early understanding of the authorship. Because if the title is added very early, then early on people recognize from Jump Street, from the get-go, that who wrote this, it was written by Mark. Now that's significant because if as many people claim, you'll run into this, depending on the circles you travel in, but if as many people claim the Gospels originally were anonymous and copies circulated throughout the Roman Empire for decades before titles supposedly were added to them in the second century, well then certainly you would expect some manuscript evidence, some copy trail of the original anonymous form. But there is no such evidence. There are no manuscripts that are anonymous, not for Mark or for any of the Gospels, in fact. They all of the manuscripts we have are titled. All of them are titled. All the ancient manuscripts indicate an author. And in addition, if the Gospels, if they were originally anonymous and the titles were added to them in the second century, you'd expect there'd be some disagreement over the regarding the titles. In other words, there's no reason to think that if we've got a scribe in Palestine or Egypt, for example, who attributes an anonymous gospel to a particular individual, there's no reason to think that a scribe in Rome would attribute that anonymous gospel to the same person. If we're just, it's anonymous, and I'm thinking, oh, I think this was written by Mark. Well, somebody else would say, here, I'm going to attribute it to Peter or somebody else. So you would have variation inevitably if these things aren't being added until the second century. And moreover, we know from Luke's gospel that there were many accounts of Christ's life that were circulating at the time Luke wrote. So you can see there'd be a need. There would be a need at that time to distinguish one account from another. So you'd have every incentive to very early on indicate that you're the author. Who is the author? Because we have a number of them out there. So I want you to know this is the gospel according to Mark. So the idea that they were anonymous and it's not till the second century that somebody just slaps on a thing, it just seems bad to me. It seems like a crummy conclusion that is pushed by skeptics trying to undermine the Bible somehow. Okay, so I want you to know these things. Now, is there indirect evidence? So there's no direct evidence in the text itself, but there is this direct evidence in the titles. Okay, that's not the text itself, but you have this thing about the titles that is direct evidence because it says this is the gospel according to Mark. Well, how about indirect evidence in the document itself? Internal, indirect evidence. Is there such a thing? And indeed there is. There are clues in the body of the gospel, indirect evidence, that support not only the early church's witness that Mark was the author, but also his having relied on Peter as his source. You have indirect evidence that corroborates that external evidence that tells us Mark wrote it based on Peter's preaching. You say, well, what is this indirect evidence? Well, the Greek style of the gospel is consistent with it having been composed by a Palestinian Jew. D.A. Carson and Douglas Moo, in their introduction to the New Testament, they say the Greek style of Mark's gospel is simple and straightforward and full of the kind of Semitisms that one would expect of a Jerusalem-bred Christian. Now, Semitisms, they're expressions in Greek that reflect Semitic, meaning Hebrew or Aramaic language patterns or modes of speech, such as word order, or redundant use of pronouns and prepositions and many other things. There are certain ways that languages are patterned. So what you have here is, if you're sophisticated enough in Greek, you can recognize that this Greek has underneath it a tone, a Semitic tone. In other words, in certain patterns. And so that is something that is recognized. And as Michael Byrd, he puts it, he says, the first gospel, the gospel of Mark, you see, it's second in our list. He calls it the first gospel because, as I'll say in a minute, most scholars think it was the first one written. But he says the first gospel, the gospel of Mark, seems to have been written by a bilingualist who was familiar enough with Greek, but whose primary language was Aramaic. All right, well, that's significant. See, that confirms if it's John Mark, who's a Palestinian Jew. Okay, well, that's that. We're getting corroboration of that from this. Now, as for the author's reliance on Peter as a source, an internationally renowned New Testament scholar, a respected New Testament scholar, Richard Baucom, he made a significant contribution on that front in his 2006 book, Jesus and the Eyewitnesses. The gospel as eyewitness testimony. He did that. Here is what Andreas Kostenberger, L. Scott Kellum, and Charles Quarles say about Baucom's contribution to this question about Mark having relied on Peter. He says, as R. Baucom has shown, Mark's gospel, by way of a literary device called the inclusio of eyewitness testimony. Then they tell you what that is. The practice of naming the major eyewitness underlying an account first and last in the document. You see, so Baucom shows that this is a technique, that if you're going to rely on a one prime witness, he's named first and last. And you see that here in the Gospel of Mark. So it said, a device called the inclusio of eyewitness testimony purports to be based on the witness of the apostle Peter. See the references to Peter in Mark 1:16 first and last, 16:7. Now, 16:8 on, there's a question about the ending of Mark, I'm sure you know, and I'll talk about that when we get to it, okay? But he says, which is also supported by early patristic evidence. Another feature, the plural to singular device, which singles out one individual from a group in order to tell an account from his perspective, makes Peter the dominant perspective in the narrative, reproducing his eyewitness recollection in first-person terms. So here you have these subtle things. You see that this person who's writing is a bilingualist whose primary language is Aramaic. Then we have him writing from the perspective of Peter and using this inclusio of eyewitness testimony to indicate that the primary source of his material is Peter, which happens to be confirmed by the external testimony that we get. And so that's all significant. And then more recently, Baucom has added to the evidence of Mark's reliance on Peter by arguing that the Galilean geography in Mark's gospel reflects the kind of mental map of the area that one would expect a first century fisherman from Capernaum to have. And you can listen to Baucom's lecture on that if you care to. You can go to his online lecture, Richard Baucom. The lecture's titled Mark's Geography and the Origin of Mark's Gospel. So all of these things come together and say it's really strong that this is John Mark who's writing this based on information he got from Peter. Barry Smith rightly concludes, he says, what internal, indirect evidence there is for the authorship of the Gospel of Mark agrees with the external, direct evidence. John Mark, being a resident of Jerusalem, would have been a Palestinian Jew having Aramaic as his first language. The conclusion follows that John Mark wrote the gospel that bears his name. Okay, now, what about the date? Well, most modern scholars date Mark to the middle or late 60s. They do that for three main reasons. Okay, the first of those is that the earliest traditions favor a date for Mark after Peter's death. Okay, so that's when that kind of sets that one limit, after Peter's death. And Mark's emphasis on following the road of the cross that was walked by Christ, he really emphasizes this. That emphasis fits with a time of persecution as began under Nero in AD 65. And then thirdly, Mark 13 is thought, you know, the apocalyptic language there and discourse. It's thought to reflect the tumult in Palestine during the Jewish revolt that began in AD 66. So those are the three reasons that lead most scholars to date the gospel to the mid-60s to the late 60s. But none of those conclusions is airtight. Okay, those three reasons aren't airtight, so you can just say, okay, it definitely is mid-60s to late 60s. It's quite possible it was written in the late 50s. That would be another good possibility. Probably 65 to 69, but quite possibly in the late 50s. And the plausibility of that dating, that depends significantly on the claims that Acts was written in AD 62. Well, Acts may have been written in AD 62, and many people think it is because they say, look, it stops with Paul in prison, and the only explanation for why it stops with Paul in prison is that it brought us right up to date, because otherwise it would have continued with what happened to Paul after he got out of prison. You see, that may be right. There can be other reasons why Luke would have stopped there, even if he wrote it later. But if Acts is written in AD 62, well, then Luke, which is written before that, that's like volume one, you know, Luke and Acts. Well, then the Gospel of Luke was written then before AD 62. And as most scholars believe, Luke drew on Mark in writing his gospel, well, then obviously Mark had to be written before that. All right, so that's why it's quite possible that Mark was written in the late 50s. Okay, but as I say, most people think mid-60s to late 60s. Now, the other main contender for dating it is the early 70s, but that proposal is largely driven by the insistence that the apocalyptic discourse in Mark 13, that was an after-the-fact creation, you see, that was then presented as a prediction of Jerusalem's fall. So they say, no, Jesus didn't really predict that. It happened, and then Mark wrote it as a prediction. You see, it had already occurred, and he just presented it as something that Jesus had predicted. Well, certainly there's no reason to think the Lord didn't predict the events beforehand in detail or predict the fall generally by using stock Old Testament and Jewish imagery of besieged cities. There's no reason to think that this had to be afterwards. And indeed, Mark, if he's writing after the fall, I mean, if he's writing after the fall of Jerusalem, why in the world would Mark invent that Jesus had exhorted the disciples to pray that the desolation of the temple not happen in winter, and then fail to point out that the prayer had in fact been granted? Right? I mean, as the temple was destroyed by the Romans in late July or early August of AD 70, why create this exhortation to pray that it not happen in winter? And then you're writing after the fact and you know that it didn't happen in winter. Why would you not then say that prayer had been answered? I mean, the whole reason you would be creating this idea, this exhortation, the only reason to invent that after the fact exhortation to pray would be to claim that the prayers uttered pursuant to the Lord's instruction had been answered. So if that's the motivation for doing it, then certainly you would have noted that the prayer had been answered. So it just seems, that doesn't seem very good to me. You know, that seems weak. All right, so mid-60s to late 60s, possibly late 50s. All right, how about the location and the audience? Now, the external evidence of that, in other words, by location, I mean where it's written and to whom it is written. All right, a document probably from the late 2nd century that's known as the Anti-Marcionite Prologue to Mark. Probably from the late 2nd century. It claims that Mark wrote his gospel in the regions of Italy. Now, Irenaeus and Clement of Alexandria, who are late 2nd century writers, they suggest the same thing. Now, the fact that 1 Peter 5:13, that text locates Mark in Rome with Peter in the early 60s, it lends credence to that. Regions of Italy, you've got Mark with Peter in Rome in the early 60s. It's sounding like he wrote this from Rome. And if Mark wrote the gospel in Rome, well, then the default assumption would be that he wrote it initially for Christians in Rome, though he certainly may have expected that it would ultimately circulate beyond that group. So the default assumption, if he's writing from Italy, writing from Rome, is that he's writing to the Christians in Rome. And there's nothing to dispel that. There's nothing contrary to that default assumption. And indeed, the internal evidence fits very comfortably with the idea that the initial audience was a Roman audience. You say, well, what in the world internal evidence could possibly help in that inquiry? Well, there are some things that point that way. In a number of places, for example, Mark translates Aramaic terms. And you can see the text up here. He translates Aramaic terms, which indicates that his audience didn't speak Aramaic. Right? I mean, you wouldn't be translating Aramaic terms if you're writing to an audience that speaks Aramaic. And he also explains Jewish terms and customs. And he notes that the location of the Mount of Olives in relation to the temple, he explains that. You see, which indicates his audience wasn't Jewish and wasn't familiar with Jerusalem. All right, well, that's significant because we're saying, okay, so that takes that region, that place out of play. Now, Mark also, he transliterates a number of Latin words into Greek. In other words, he simply takes the Latin word and Greekifies it. You see, which is indicating that they are a Latin connected people. And there are a number of places that he does that. And elsewhere, he uses Greek words that have been borrowed from Latin. Greek words that have been borrowed from Latin to explain other Greek words. In other words, you get the sense that they're more familiar, more comfortable with Latin. And so he uses Greek words that have been borrowed from Latin to explain other Greek words. And there are also places where he uses Latin idioms. You know, languages, you have idioms. And he takes those idioms from the Latin language, but expresses them in Greek. So all of that points to this sense, gives you this sense that these people are comfortable with Latin. As Barry Smith says, the presence of Latinisms and Latin translations of Greek words in the Gospel of Mark implies that the intended readers were Latin speakers, even though they could read or at least understand Greek. Latin speakers would have been found most readily in Italy, although not exclusively. All right, so we have this external evidence that he's writing in the regions of Italy. And then we have this internal evidence that seems to go along with that and corroborate that. And in fact, the identification in Mark 15:21 of Simon of Cyrene as the father of Alexander and Rufus, that suggests that the people to whom he's writing, they were familiar with Alexander and Rufus. I mean, why would you say Simon is the father of Alexander and Rufus if nobody's gotten any idea who Alexander and Rufus are? You see, so that indicates that the people to whom he's writing know Alexander and Rufus. And it just so happens that a man named Rufus is mentioned in Romans chapter 16, verse 13, as being a member of the church in Rome. All right, all of these little pieces and all of these little clues wind up, you know, they go into these conclusions that he's writing this in Rome. He's writing this gospel in Rome. And what's the purpose? Well, he doesn't specify, so you kind of have to speculate. But at the very least, it seems, as Carson and Moo say, that Mark wanted to help his readers understand who Jesus is and what real discipleship involves. And I really see this theme in Mark. What real discipleship involves? And if there's a message that the church needs to hear, that's one of them. He also probably wanted to provide his readers a written record of Jesus' life and teaching. He wanted to do that as encapsulated in Peter's preaching and to anchor them to the truth of the gospel and arm them for sharing that good news. So in terms of introduction, here's the conclusion. All right, the Gospel of Mark, probably written in Rome in the mid to late 60s, although possibly in the late 50s, written by John Mark, and it was based significantly on information he received from the Apostle Peter. It was originally intended for Gentile Christians in Rome, but it may have been expected to circulate beyond that group, and its purpose was to instruct, to strengthen, and embolden the Christians there. Now, let me give you just a little bit of miscellaneous information. I want to say just briefly about the synoptic puzzle. But the Gospel of Mark, of course, it's the shortest of the four Gospels, some of the best known events and teachings of Jesus, such as the birth stories, the Beatitudes, and various parables, they're not found in Mark. Some of the best known events and teaching are not found in the Gospel of Mark. On the other hand, there's some material that's unique to Mark, such as the parable of the seed growing secretly, the healing of the deaf and the mute man in chapter 7, and the healing of the blind man of Bethsaida in chapter 8. You see, so some things that you're very familiar with aren't in the Gospel of Mark, and yet there are other things that are unique to the Gospel of Mark. And when one compares the synoptic gospel, by synoptic, you know, I mean Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Okay, when one compares those three gospels in detail, it becomes immediately apparent that they have close similarities, including identical wording in places. You know, for sentences, identical wording that you have in places. Okay? And yet they also have some significant differences in content, in wording, in order. There certainly seems to be some kind of literary relationship between these three Gospels, some kind of sharing of written material. In other words, so that we're all on the same source because we're all identical. So there seems to be some kind of literary sharing, but the nature of that relationship is unclear. Exactly what is the relationship that accounts for the similarities that we see in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and for the differences? How can we, we're trying to think about how these Gospels were constructed. We're looking, we see clues here because we see a clear literary affinity, some kind of borrowing or sharing, and yet we see these differences. So what's going on here? And that's what's popularly known as the synoptic problem. But as I said, it's better termed the synoptic puzzle. And it's been the subject of intense scholarly study, trying to figure out just exactly how were these Gospels constructed. Now, most scholars today are convinced that the Gospel of Mark was the first of the four Gospels written. They think that in composing their Gospels, here is the most popular four-source theory. So most people think that, look, Mark wrote first, and then Matthew and Luke both had access to Mark and used Mark. But Matthew and Luke also used another source. It's a hypothetical source dubbed Q. Well, what is Q? That's from a German word, Quell, which means source. Okay, why do they think that they use this hypothetical source? Because there are places in Matthew and Luke that you have that are identical, but not in Mark. So it looks like they're drawing on a common source, but it wasn't Mark. So you have it looks like most people think, look, you have Mark writing, Matthew and Luke have access to Mark. It seems they also have access to this other document, and then they also have access to independent sources. So that's how most scholars today understand this synoptic puzzle. But other scholars continue to reject Mark in priority. They say, no, Mark wasn't written first, favoring Matthew. And other scholars reject the notion of this hypothetical source Q. Okay? So that's what's called the synoptic puzzle or the synoptic problem. And if you want a good presentation of the majority view, if this interests you and you want to look into it some more, I suggest that you look at Daniel Wallace's online article titled The Synoptic Problem. You can dig through that, and people get off on this and you know, go into a lot of detail. Interesting, if your mind runs that way. All right. I heard that bell a while ago. Second bell is going to ring soon, I know. But I did want to launch into the text. See, I didn't know how much of this class would be devoted to introduction, but almost all of it. There you have it. Right. The first section I want to look at is chapter 1, verses 1 to 15, which I dub here the beginning of the gospel, preparation and presentation. Mark begins in chapter 1, verse 1. He says, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Second bell? Ah, well, good timing. All right. Next week, Lord willing. Thank you.